Dr. Fred Baker is a forest pathologist from Utah State University. He works in the same department with me. Actually, he used to be an extension forester here in the state, originally. But also has a lot of background in global positioning systems. And I asked Fred to come talk to us about that today.
Thanks. I am a plant pathologist by training. She came to us from the Midwest, where they have lots of pests. We've got a few here, too. The reason I got into GPS is that I do a lot of disease surveys. You want to know what you have and where you have it. And I've been dragged into it kicking and screaming because everything's on GIS now. My GPS unit is one of these and one of these. You don't need batteries. It works in the dark. It works when it's 20 below zero. And still have to have one of these even if you do use a GPS unit. But in preparing for this group, I didn't, introductory GPS is kind of boring. You want to get to it. But there's some things you need to know about it because it's changing. And I started looking around the internet to see what's going on out there. And it really blew me away because there's a lot of different things going. And I actually stole pieces of different presentations here because the presentation I had was kind of droll and nuts and bolts. And there's a whole different side of GPS that we don't see in resource management that's going to give you an idea of where we're going to go in the future. So I kind of tried to tease some of that out of these presentations and finally just said, I'm going to put my stuff into the presentation so that you get the flavor for where things are going, because this is really a big thing. So, it's Cold War spinoff. We wanted to be able to get people to where they wanted to be. And there's stories of commanders ordering units to go someplace, they go the wrong way, and they end up engaging their own, the good guys. That didn't work. In the first Gulf War, you saw the pictures of them dropping the bomb down the smokestack. That was GPS-based stuff. When they did 9/11, I have a brother who developed some weapon, and he was out. He was actually in the Pentagon that morning, flying, and then they left at 6 a.m. to go out to a missile testing range in the Atlantic. I don't know what it was. He didn't tell me, but the story was, he said, look, we were fishing one day, and he said, you know, it would be really cool if we could take a missile coming at you and send it back to where it came from. And he said, you can do that. He's an electrical engineer with Honeywell, designs navigation systems. He said, we can do that, but then the jokers will just use write one's memory, so once it's gone, so we can't send it. But I think he came up with some sort of way of telling the blocking GPS satellite or broadcasting GPS satellite signals to this thing so that it goes up there and it gets a position on where it's supposed to be. And, oh, I need to go over here. It goes over here and runs out of fuel. And if you're lucky, it crashes on the bad guys. But anyway, he did that. And especially after that Korean Airlines flight that strayed into space and paid the ultimate price, they decided that we better make this available to everybody so we know where we are. Today, the commercial use dwarfs military use. Even with the war on, I find that hard to believe, but as we go through this, you'll see it's the case, I think. There is a national group that manages GPS policy, and they implement some of it, but most of it's left to the commercial aspects. The president signed off on it. It's supposed to remain free of charge to users. Okay? You're not going to get charged for using it. And there's a promotion and acceptance of a worldwide standard. Because it doesn't do you any good if you're flying in an airliner and somebody changes the protocols midstream. Select availability ended in May of 2000. And that really catapulted the use of GPS, because before that, the military fuzzed up the signal so we couldn't figure out where we were accurately. Now we're as good as they are. Well, not quite, and we'll talk a little bit about that. But with selective availability, it suddenly became a really useful tool. Our policy is to encourage private sector investment in the use of GPS technology and services. And you think about that and say, well, you know, okay, you heard OnStar, combination cell phone and GPS. You can get GPS here at cell phones. In fact, I think it's going to be a standard here that all cell phones have it. You can turn it off, except for 911 purposes. The idea is that we're looking at safety and efficiency of transportation. There's actually design systems being designed now that are in your car, and they know everybody else's car, and if you get too close, it beeps at you. We don't have them yet, but they're playing with that. We want to get GPS used for peaceful purposes internationally. We've got wonderful scientific capabilities, and of course the security issues. This was kind of mind-boggling to me. This is obviously an older slide, but the growth, this is projected growth of GPS stuff, the GPS industry. I did a check and found that the 2002 was probably about a 10% underestimate, the reality versus what they predicted here. So it's growing. It's not going away. You've seen the OnStar thing. I pity the poor fools that don't learn to read roadmaps, but there's people saying that roadmaps are going to be gone in 10 years. We're all going to have one of these goofy TVs now. The consumer market, you can't open anything. You see it in the Cabela's flyers that we get in our newspapers, all have GPS units in it. If you open up a boat catalog now, you can buy a fish finder, but you got to have a fish finder with a GPS on it so you know where you were. I like the old technique of just marking a spot on the side of the boat. The surveying now, you don't see anything but GPS units. That's the only way to make hay.
Do you have a feel, Fred, for how that market is mixed? How much is recreational, how much is commercial this way? What's the money going in, commercial or recreational?
It's going recreational, the car market. You're starting to see the delivery trucks. Sears has got them now, the pods on top. FedEx has them. They know where you are. Some school buses have them now. I don't know why. I mean, they're big and orange. You can't hide them. Trucking industry is using them, too. I don't know if they're doing that. GPS is playing an important role in tracking things. You're seeing containers now with GPS. We know where that container is. Search and rescue, you've all heard about the fools that get up on their cell phone, here's my GPS coordinates, come get me. And I walk out, chump. There's a tremendous, everything we do, we're finding ways to deal with it. City planning is really coming into its own now. As I'm working in urban forestry, sometimes we have to do things with trees that involve digging. If you've got a GIS and you know where the utilities are, you can go out in the field and say, gas pipeline here, don't dig. There are operator errors that lead to interesting consequences. I've watched somebody with a vibratory plow clip a gas line, and I never saw anybody do the 50-yard dash that quickly, pop a key and was gone. But there are challenges there. Fire departments are using it. They're using it in routing. But all of this requires that we have good data and accuracy in GPS. And we'll get to some of that. Aviation. GPS has finally been improved for navigation in planes. And there's been some augmentation of the GPS system so that the planes have accuracy. But the important thing for us crew members is that the planes are usually up in the air. And that matters because they get to see more satellites and better satellites than we get. There's talk about using GPS to figure out who's out there and how close they get so the air traffic controller doesn't have to worry about this. It's all computerized. And software glitches are really painful. So it comes slowly. Maritime navigation, that fellow that just put the cruise ship on the reef, I don't know what he was thinking. I don't know if the currents really got him, but the GPS should have helped him. But if you don't have the feature mapped, the GPS doesn't do you any good. And you hate to be the first one that finds that reef. Scientific research has been wonderful for us because we've been able to, one that's really useful is the GPS collar. We can track animals now, and some of them have a radio uplink that we can download the data from the elk without, or the moose without getting near it, so that we can figure out where he's been for the last month. We can learn about him. Coyotes. We're learning about coyote behavior with GPS collars. There's logistics. You got to get the collar on the animal, and some of these animals don't like that. It's a real costly operation, but we get better data. It costs us the same amount of money to have a person follow a single coyote around and figure out what it does as it does to rent a helicopter, put 10 coyotes on the ground, and get GPS collars. So we're changing the way that we do these things. Oh, there's a bunch of new stuff happening in GPS right now that is, people are working with the technology. And the big one is differential GPS. That's coming to us. It isn't here yet, but it's coming. Differential GPS is essentially navigational quality GPS, but I believe it's the U.S. Coast Guard that has put this in around here, but it's becoming a worldwide standard. But it's the same concept that we use in our survey grade GPS. What we do with survey grade is we put a known transmitter right here in a known location, and it sends a radio signal to our receiver. As it gets the signals from the satellites, and it knows exactly where it's here, it gets signals from the satellite, and it can adjust everything to centimeter accuracy. We're talking meter accuracy with differential GPS, but I can get that with this, and not my $6,000 or $8,000 Trimble unit. So suddenly, you know, we're heading in that direction. We're not there yet. Some of these other things, we're doing different things about looking at relative differential GPS. If you've got more stations, you can get even more accurate, but it requires, like cell phones, if you think back to the ages of cell phones, now you can go a lot of places and have coverage. There were other times where you'd go through big gaps, and we're in that big gap phase with differential GPS. Once we get the network tightened down, we can move to differential GPS and get even more accurate. And so we keep moving in this direction towards more accuracy. Folks are playing games with tweaking that signal that we get to make it even more accurate. If we can play more games with the signal, we can do the magic and get a better position with less time. So there's a lot of things happening here. These last two post-processing's coming, but we all want a real time. If I'm out in the field, I want to know I'm standing here and not over there. So we're seeing attempts to minimize those things or enhance it for those applications that can live that way. This is a great old chart that I pulled off of someplace, and the cost of GPS units is falling, and they were talking about them getting down here somewhere around $25. Well, the industry figured that one out. Like, let's flatten this curve out here, or we're going to go extinct. Well, they're adding new features all the time, so they could justify that. But the point is, GPS units, instead of being really expensive, are affordable. You can get one of these things for $100 now. That'll do a lot of what we need to do. It isn't going away. It's going to be with us here for a while. So, talk about a little bit what it is. GPS is made up of three segments. There's a control segment on the ground. There are space segments that consist of satellites. And then there's the user. And we'll talk about each of these components. The control segment basically talks to the satellites. They don't talk to us. They talk to the satellites. They adjust the satellites for their orbits, for everything else. The Grand Poobah is U.S. Space Command. I think there in Nebraska. I'm not sure. There are other sites elsewhere in the world that can talk to satellites. But the idea is, what we've got are a bunch of satellites up there that are clocks. They send a radio signal out that tells the world where they are. These are atomic clocks in those satellites. These guys are atomic clocks. But when that satellite orbit strays out because we have a solar flare, these guys can triangulate on that satellite, figure out where it really is, and adjust it so that we're all there. We don't see that stuff. It's all going on behind the curtain.
Is this on U.S.-based systems?
This is U.S.-based systems. The Russians have a system, and I think there's one other system. But, okay. There's a, but they're all...
They're not integrated.
They aren't integrated yet, but it looks like they're going to. And I'll show you a couple slides. The space segment of that consists of satellites. And all these guys are doing is broadcasting a tune out there. Just a pattern, and we'll talk about that in a second here. There's 24 of them in our network plus some spares. So when somebody dies, you can actually get another satellite as the Earth turns to fall in. Apparently they can move these things and get it into the right place. And there's actually a graph. You can look at the demographics of the satellite and see who's getting old and ready to retire and where the new ones are. And some of them, they actually have put the backup satellite in place, and they're just waiting for the old one to die before they turn the new one on. But the network is out there. Pretty much the idea is that you want to have three or four satellites or more in the horizon at any point in time. Well, the users, we talked about all these guys, different uses, GIS, recreation, whatever. The idea is that there's people on the ground with receivers. There's four things that GPS does for us. Well, position and coordinates. It tells us where we are on this Earth. We can get the distance and direction between any two points, and we can determine those points, which gives us the speed that we get sighted for our little ticket for. We can go anywhere from where we are to where we want to go. It tells us how fast we're going, how much time we have left, how long we've been on the road, how far, all that good stuff. But the main thing is that little receiver, this guy, is nothing but a timepiece. It's a clock. It's a clock. But your position at any point in time is based on time. And basically the satellite is sending out a signal, the receiver picks it up and is able to figure out from the pattern of the signal how long it took to get there, and therefore, because this thing travels at the speed of light, multiply it out, you know how far away you are from that satellite. And then if you've got a bunch of satellites, you can figure out how far they are from each other, and you can get your position. What they do is they generate a pseudo-random noise code, and it's just tones and non-tones in a certain pattern, some time pattern, and your receiver listens for that pattern, and it knows what satellite. It's programmed with all the satellites and all of their patterns. So it listens and says, oh, you're satellite 5. I know your pattern. And the two of them set up the pattern and they mimic. And it's based on the offset in that pattern, we can calculate where we are. And basically, if there's a satellite here, I calculate my distance. I get a distance from that satellite, but I can be in a circle anywhere around it. So we add a second satellite. This is the ideal situation. I know that I'm a certain distance from this guy. I'm on this circle. And if I know that I'm a certain distance from this guy, I can be on that circle. But the solution there is not a single point. These two spheres intersect in a circle, so I can be anywhere around in a circle. If you remember, those two points there were basically somewhere in a circle where those two spheres intersect. If we add a third solution there, now we can say that we're on a point, more or less. Okay? We're on a point, but because we're multiplying the time frames here by 186,000, there's a little bit of error in there. We really need a fourth one to help us out. And with three situations, we can be, with three satellites, we can be in this area or in this area up here. But normally, we've got a pretty good idea because the GPS unit also knows where these satellites are supposed to be in the sky. 5 is supposed to be next to 21. And if I'm seeing 521, I'm here, and I'm not over in Egypt someplace. And so they cheat a little bit there. But we have that fourth one, and we can tie it down to a point, an elevation on the surface of the Earth. So we can get a, if you don't need elevation, three satellites are enough. In a lot of our uses, we want to know elevation, and so a fourth one becomes important. If you're working off in the prairies, you really don't need that fourth satellite because you can get a pretty good position. Okay, select availability. A lot of the things that we heard about GPS initially, the military didn't want the bad guys to be able to figure out where we were. And so they fuzzed up that signal. And so we could be plus or minus 30 meters at times. Well, depending on what we're doing, that can be good or bad. The Pentagon decided to forget that because everybody had GPS anyway, and you know we're top dog right now. But we can fuzz that signal anytime we want to. And there were certain, during the first Gulf War, people surveying in the Middle East, when they turned selective availability on, everybody was out surveying because they got a better position fix than they did. And as soon as the U.S. Turned it off, activity died down.
So can they turn that on and off with certain?
They can if they want to, they haven't. But this is a kind of an idea. This is just happens to be in Colorado Springs, Colorado. You can see the horizontal and vertical areas there with selective availability turned on. And you could be plus or minus 100 meters from where you were. And my first experience with GPS was actually going out in a place in Idaho, walking on, taking a hike, and coming back, and I'm standing on the front porch of the cabin I left from, and it told me I had to go 300 meters that way, and I'm like, I don't think so. So I kind of went back to my map and compass. But once they turn this off, your error drops down to less than 5 meters. We can probably live with that.
And that's off now?
It's off now, and likely to stay off. The key thing is that there are a lot of sources of error that can come from in GPS. The satellite clocks can be up to 3 meters of that error. The orbital errors, we've got a pretty good handle on where that satellite is, but it can introduce about a meter into the process. The atmosphere, on some days, there's just stuff going on up there that you're not going to get a good tune. And when that happens, you just have to punt on it. The noise from that we pick up with our receivers, electric lines. If you set the receiver in the windshield of your car, those radios, it's receiving a signal. It's bouncing off your windshield, your hood. You're fuzzying up that signal in here. And your GPS unit doesn't know the difference. So you have to, you get noise introduced in there. User error, I haven't seen a definition of user error yet, but it may have to do with not reading the thing properly. We'll assume that that's minimal. If you introduced a kilometer of error, it's back to the map and compass, I think. Okay, we see all these different sources. You're bouncing off buildings, wires, all kinds of stuff are out there. And so you say, well, maybe working in the woods is the place to be. Maybe, maybe not. But the big thing about these errors is that they add up to each other. And if I'm standing here in the middle of that, and I'm standing there for a while, You know, a sunspot hits, and I get a point out here, and I get a point out here. And one of the techniques we try to do to minimize the importance of those errors is to average. But if it's taking you a long time to get points because of atmosphere, because of canopy cover, we get impatient. When it's 20 below zero, I don't like to be standing there waiting to collect a bloody point. I get 3 or 4 points and I'm off. And it's okay if I get these 3, if I'm lucky, but I may get this one, and that one. And so you have to think about your use and what that error means to you. If you're looking at trying to land an airplane, that can be an oops. That can be an oops. I've got a friend who has the GPS system in his airplane, and he says it'll come down, and he can land, he can bring it down to about 10 feet off the ground, and the plane will come that close, and after that, you better wake up and land it. Theoretically, it'll land for you, but if you've got that bad point, ouch. Well, what we use these for is for positioning, figuring out where we are, or getting someplace we need to go. And we start with an active waypoint, where we're coming from, and a place we want to go. Now, in the old days, you laid out your map, you took a bearing here, and you paced it. You guys work in the woods, you still pace? How many paces to a chain?
Yeah.
Good on you, mate. Yeah. 16.5 for me. Short in scene, you know. But the idea is you can work along that way. Well, now, with the GPS unit, you tell it, I want to go there, and you'll wander along. There's a lot of technical stuff there that you can get into, but let's see here. That's the way most of us go. Now, if you're compass and pacing, this is a bad scene. If you're looking for a section corner in the woods, you got a problem. You get to where you think you're supposed to be, but I hear you've walked that mile. Is it to the right, to the left, to the middle? You throw your hat up in a tree and start circling. With the GPS unit, I think this will get us there. By looking at where you go, as you progress along this thing, the GPS tells you, hey, you're over here now, go that way. And if you walk off, it says, hey, you got to go this way. And I did a number of surveys for Dwarf Mistletoe last year in semi-frozen swamps on snowshoes, and we were walking circles that are a mile in diameter. And basically, you just start at one point in the circle, walk across, come back on another one, and we just programmed the points that we wanted to get to, and you just walk down looking at this thing, and you just walked along. And it would tell you you're a tenth of a mile out, and then it would switch over to 500 feet. Life was good when you got to the feet stage. And you'd get to an endpoint of about 10 or 15 feet, and you were there. Because as you slow down, the GPS doesn't work. It can't tell you where you are. It can tell you where you've been and where you're going. Because it measures, it's a clock, and it's measuring rates and times. And as you move, it says you were there before, but now you're here. I know where you're at. So from standpoint of navigating to these things, I can get to within 15, 20 feet, and I can usually find my section. So life is pretty useful that way. When you try to get a position, so you're out there and you find the big one log, the elusive one log tree, you've got to get your position from the satellites that you're tracking. You end up with coordinates. You just are where you are. You can be anywhere along that line. It doesn't have a name to it. It just represents approximately where you are. Really, we're trying to figure out where we want to go. If we're there, the position isn't going to stop. As the GPS moves, or more importantly, those random errors come up, you're going to say, you'll be standing at the section corner, and it's going to say, you need to go 15 feet that way. And so you go 15 feet that way, and he said, nope, go back that way, and you can end up walking around. Mm-hmm. And when you get to that end point, your position is just going to bounce around because you're there. The farther you are between two points, the easier it is to figure out which way you have to go to get there. If you're trying to tell somebody how many degrees are this far apart, it's hard to get that. It's like when you sight with a compass, you always pick something on the, as far on the horizon as you can go rather than the tree right in front of you because your errors are less magnified. So it helps to... GPS works as we move to close distances. And what this means here is that you've got to have three or four satellites to figure that out. If you don't have a good position, you don't know where you are or where you're going to go. And four satellites is better than three. The more satellites you have, the better you are. Waypoints are points that you want to get to, either as a destination or as route points. And we would frequently do this on the last surveys. We'd be snowmobiling into these stands. We have every road intersection where you had to make a turn, we pick a point off the GIS, stick it in the GPS unit so that we knew we were there, and we just navigate to the next one. You'd be driving the snowmobile looking down, and when you got close, you know, you look for the road and make your turn. You can save it or you can enter coordinates. Most of us don't like to enter coordinates off the maps. If you can find another way to get those coordinates, i.e. off of GIS, life can be good. And I'll show you some tricks with that. You can create it for anywhere on the earth, and you've got to give it a name so that you can call it up in your receiver. And that's what happens when you use these things for fishing. You know, somebody's got bass, walleye, perch, whatever, but bass one, bass two, you got to figure all these things out. And these things stay in the memory of this unit, even when you pull the batteries out, they stay there until you delete them. And that gets to be a challenge because a lot of people just go out and they use that unit, and then one day it chokes. And you've got to decide what to get rid of. And again, I think I can show you a solution for that problem. So when you plan a route, how come people don't like to go over hills? You know, you could go straight across there. If we were certainly walking that line, you would. I don't know why they went that way. I'd go this way. Pick your points that you can have and navigate to those points. And you can get these by downloading maps onto your PC and then pulling them off that way. That's a lot easier than figuring out the coordinates with rulers. I get those screwed up. And that's what happens if you use your GPS. But the thing to remember is that at each of these points, you may not be there, you may be out here. And the GPS doesn't know that. It's going to average things. Because it's doing its best, but there's stuff happening out there. And in an operational world, you have to realize that there's going to be some error that some days it's going to be worse than others. When we were doing our surveys, we did a month of these things. We had 1 week or three afternoons in a row, we just lost satellites, and it was literally to the compass and paper for an hour and a half until the GPS unit came back. You get circles of errors out there, and if you map these things, if you try to map your route, you'll see these zigzags in your route. They're not real. It's just that you've got that wild coordinate. Although, we're processing data from one of our surveyors in Canada, and one of the things had a big zag in it all the time. About every hour or so, there'd be a big zag, and we just kind of noticed this after looking at this person's data. Turned out it was a woman working with a man's crew, and she had to go to the restroom. So she darted to the side, and her GPS was on, and we'd see these little zaps. Okay, delusional precision is basically it means there's uncertainty about your where you are. It's called DOP, or in sometimes positional delusional precision is PDOP. And on the high end units, or even on some of these now, we can say if that coordinate is so far from where I think I am, throw it out. Or, well, I can say that I need to have absolutely perfect satellites in order to collect that point or throw it out. And we'll walk through some pictures of this. The satellite geometry can affect what you see and where you see it. And what that means is if the satellites are all bunched up relative to where you are, you can't discern your position. It's like, again, if you're trying to triangulate something, you want to pick objects way on the horizon so you get a better pick of where you are. And I've actually done a bunch of that. One of the experiments I did is on a lake I fish in northern Minnesota. I have a spot that I've lined up shore marks, and I've fished it for a long time. There's big crappies there. And I turn the GPS unit on, go out, fish, come back, turn it off, do that 5 days in a row, and I find that I can get within 15 feet of that spot using triangulation. But I've got good satellite geometry up there. That's as good as the GPS would do for me.
Is 24 satellites evenly spread or continuous distribution?
They're hopefully evenly spread. But again, I'll show you a depiction of where they are and what matters, because in northern Minnesota, Canada, and places like that, you know, they kind of tend to be buffered over the U.S. travel corridors. You know, places that the military thinks is important. And they can actually pull satellites in and move the satellites to where they need to be. I'm sure that there's an overrepresentation in the Middle East right now. But some places where you are, you may not be able to see all the satellites that are out there. We don't need to really worry about this except to understand that there are errors out there and the GPS knows about it, and we can tell our GPS units not to use those points with lots of errors. Ideally, you want to have one satellite right above you and three scattered around the horizon, which gives you a good fix on your position. But the real world doesn't work that way. You want to be able to minimize that error circle down there because of the way the two satellites see you. If they're all right on top of you, they're not. This satellite isn't telling you anything that this satellite isn't. And so you want to have them spread out from all different sides if you can. You really want to have one over the top of you. It just seems that one's going to be much more accurate and more helpful to you. Now, there are actually programs that you can say, I'm going to go out surveying on Thursday afternoon. What's the best time for me to be out for this location? Where are the best? When's the best time to be out there to get the best satellite coverage? And you can find that out. They've calculated that for you. Okay. What poor satellite geometry does is just maximizes that area of uncertainty. When we talk about differential GPS, a lot of us heard about differential correction. And in the old days, when selective availability was turned on, we could actually go to a station, collect the data, and because those stations knew where they were, they would read the signals and calculate an error. And then we would apply that error rate to our data. And so you actually had to post-process this stuff. Well, today, folks, it's coming to us real time. It's getting there. The difference today is that we now have a differential GPS site. If you're using the survey-grade Trimble's, that's what that little broadcast station is. It's not a house with a big antenna. It's a little pod that you set up over benchmark. And then you go and survey your stuff. And what this does is, because this is a known location, it knows exactly where it is. It figures out how much error there is in the satellites, corrects for it, and sends that to you, and it adjusts your position accordingly. This is all math, and we don't need to do a math class. But what does it give you? It tends to bring in those coordinates such that we're down to about a meter of an error now. If you can't find the section corner when you go through the meter of it, you're in trouble. That's real-time stuff. Sometimes if the closer you are to that station, the less error. You can get up to maybe half a meter, but you know, it degrades a meter over 150 kilometers, over 100 miles. I can live with that. I can live with that. If you post-process this thing, you can get 2 to 5 centimeters with accuracy. I can't walk that straight. I wish I could. You don't worry about that stuff. Where you get, there's some problems with availability of these signals. The signals get lost because they're broadcast from the ground. And that's why we see things like the carrier wave technology, because they'd like to be able to do this from a satellite so you can see it wherever you are. You know, if I'm over the horizon, I miss that sound. If I drop down into a canyon, I miss that signal, and I don't get differential GPS. Coming to a world near us soon. The yellow areas have it. The green areas don't have much of it. So we're not there yet. We're hoping. I guess this is why you see all the stuff in your car, the navigation. Differential GPS would really be nice. And when it gets here, and the plan is to make it come here, it's going to be helpful.
So it's gray areas.
Gray areas? I think the gray areas don't have any coverage at all. I think the green areas may have coverage.
We have limited coverage.
We have limited coverage, but I'm not aware that we have terrain out here, and that makes a big difference. Our terrain interferes with a lot of the signals. I know this one up here because that's in Pine River, Minnesota. There's a U.S. Coast Guard site up there, and it's the U.S. Coast Guard that has actually done this for navigation. But it's supposedly becoming an international standard, and my understanding is that all the areas in the green there, or the blue areas, already have it in Europe. And again, that looks like navigational type stuff. It's a nationwide standard, and it seems to be happening. This is a little coarser scale, but it's already in places around the world. So it's not going to go away. It's only going to become more popular. But I wish they'd kind of get into the Intermountain West a little bit. And I think it's our terrain that disrupts us. One of the cures to this system is the FAA wanted to get into this. They weren't quite, GPS wasn't reliable for them to navigate airplanes. And so they put in the Wide Area Augmentation System, WAAS. Most of our GPS units, unless you've really got a dinosaur, pick that up. There's a couple other satellites up there that are there that just kind of fill in the holes. So it was an attempt by the FAA to do a better job of navigating for these guys. But the beauty of it is that these guys are up at 20, 35,000 feet playing their game. So they're going to see a lot more satellites than we see on the ground. And so if they needed that, we needed even more down here. And how good is it? It can basically move you from plus or minus 15 meters to 3 meters, which is what most of us have today with these little units like this. And they're pretty much there, I think. They've got everybody. Poor Nevada, southern Idaho. I'm sure that those areas have it now. I haven't driven through there with a GPS unit on, but I would expect that they have it because they do fly planes along this corridor there.
So wider areas that it doesn't bring, areas it does.
What the red are the towers that are either online or supposed to be online, and the gray would be the area that's covered. So I think it's pretty much everywhere here, and I wouldn't be surprised if they filled in those holes.
Is the triangle of the light one without a solid center, are those proposed?
Yeah. I think they're actually on. This was projected by 2000, so I suspect that they're already on board. The red ones at the time of this slide were already online.
And this is the WAAS?
Right. And the Canadians have also put this system in because we've got it. Apparently this was done by one of our U.S. officials and didn't want to acknowledge our neighbors to the north. Okay, this is one that is really fascinating to me. The types of GPS units that we have, there's the Trimble unit, which this unit's probably about, well, we paid $6,000 for them, they dropped down to about $4,000. This unit, I think, is the newer one, the Pro XR, I think I want to call that one. We have a couple of those that are, I think they were about $7,000 by the time you drop everything on them. Or this is the Trimble XL, I'm sorry. This is a Garmin unit of some color, and that is a Magellan unit. And the key thing here is that all of these units have external antennas. And we played a great trick on us, one of our technicians one time. We're driving down the road and said, you've got to hold this antenna out the window. We didn't tell him it was magnetic. He could have stuck it on the roof. So here's this poor guy driving miles of road hanging this out the window. This is a comparison done by some Forest Service folks in the year 2000. There's a lesson here. The Pro XR and the Geo Explorer 3 are the expensive ones, the Garmins, and that's some kind of, I forget what that one is. But basically, if you look at the error in positions, the Pro XR received best, and this was up around Montana, and so they were getting the differential GPS here. But basically, in those terrain situations, you're right around 10-meter error, except for the Pro XR. If you look at the positional errors, this is in a flatland to the east of Missoula. Your expensive ones did okay. They're all about the same here. And that's the bottom line of this whole study. If you've got good satellites with a good external antenna, the Garmins are just as good as the others. And for $5,500 or more in my pocket, I like that idea. Same thing again here. If you look at your error in an open field, yeah, the real expensive one does well, but can you live with being 6 meters from where you need to be? I can. For that kind of money, I can. I'm not surveying here. You can correct and uncorrect them. If you post-process them, you can improve that error a little bit there. External and internal antennas make a difference. If you're going to use this thing in the forest, you've got to have an external antenna for it. It really helps. We found during our surveys, without the external antennas, you had to hold the bloody thing out here. And you walk all day through the forest like this, your arm gets tired. If you take and just hook the external antenna on and set it on a backpack, you can clip them to your hat and put the thing in your pocket, except it's nice to know that it's working. But you just carry it down and lift it every once in a while to make sure it's there. So if you're going to get one of these, make sure you get the external antenna.
I don't see how that external antenna would be much of an improvement. It's still only a 2 or 3 or 4 feet of improvement.
Yes, but the internal antenna is sitting here. My body may be blocking out a satellite. If you could take, when we surveyed plantations in Canada, we developed a backpack with a sewn-in sleeve with a broomstick on it with a dowel that goes up about over the head of the person and puts the antenna up there. And it probably makes it definitely makes a big difference, just getting it away from your body. If you can hold it out here, you get it away from your body, but I'm doing a lot of physical therapy now. I don't think I want to be doing that. When you don't have good satellite geometry, the expensive ones don't do any better than the cheap ones. Okay, so the moral of that story is, depending on what you're going to do, you can do it with this piece of equipment. If you're just trying to keep track of where you are, where you've been, you can do that. I wouldn't want to survey with one of these units, but they can certainly gets you to where you need to go. Now, this unit is one of the, I guess this is about a $120 unit. We use these with our surveyors in Canada every summer because we could not afford $6,000 for 14 people to be out surveying with these units. Well, the first year we put these out, they were losing them and dropping them in the swamps and everything else. So we finally figured out that, you know, if you finish the summer with that GPS unit, you get to keep it. That was cheaper. All of a sudden, they care about them. The only thing that this GPS unit doesn't do is attribute the points. I can't create a data dictionary on it. But when I save my route or I save my points, I have to give it a name. And so if you can develop a code for naming those points, you can actually accomplish the same thing. The difficulty, the difference between this and the Garmins, and I tried to find our Garmins, both of mine are out. So I don't have anybody, Trimble's. The Trimble has a much easier to use alphanumeric keypad for writing things down in the GPS unit. That's the difference here. So depending upon what you're going to do, if you need to be surveying to the centimeter, then a Trimble's the way to go. But if you're trying to lay out a timber sale line, this is going to do it for you. If you're trying to figure out the area of something, this is going to do it for you with a few little tools. One of the things you'll find, and I don't mean to be bad-mouthing Trimble, but those of us who've dealt with them over any part of time, they're very difficult to deal with, and they've got a solution to every problem, but it costs a lot of money. And we had a unit break on us during our surveys in northern Minnesota before we went to these. It popped up an error code, so I called them and said, "It's giving us this error code. We don't know what that means." Well, is there anybody who does? Well, no. Well, then why do they program it in there? Well, we think you need a new battery. It's a $400 battery later. The unit's still giving you the same error code. And you just kind of throw up your hands. The software, you can get the unit, and then you have to get the cable, and that's $50. The software is $350. If you want to upgrade that, it's another $100. And, you know, they seem to think we have money. The way around that is to take our... A lot of people have said that we can't afford to put people in the field with tools. And Minnesota DNR did that, and they finally said, you know, using proprietary software from the GPS maker to download software into our GIS and everything is a pain in the rear. So they wrote their own little program that accesses Garmin's. And it's a freebie. You can go to the net and download it. I just did that this morning. But the idea here is that we have a nice little interface for communicating with my GPS unit. I can take data from a map, put them into here. I can go to my GIS, save a table of points, dump them into here, name them here, tell them what kind of unit it is, and say, put that in my GPS unit so that when I go out in the woods, I can say, take me to wherever I need to go and away I go. That's a freebie. There is a lot of places you can learn about these things. This is one time it's wise to read your manual on your GPS unit. These are Garmin's. You can get these on the internet. Just an introduction to GPS and how to use your Garmin. They all come with manuals that do a real nice job of this, of telling you what to do. This is Magellan. Wonderful little GPS units. But you can find a lot of places, but the manual that comes with your GPS unit is going to help you the most of them. One of the necessities that you're going to need for your GPS unit is a cable. You've got to be able to talk to the computer unless you like keying in those goofy coordinate numbers by hand. I'm dyslexic. I can't do that, man. I'd be lost. I'd be running around the North Pole right now. You got two choices. There's just a straight data cable, and a lot of them offer you one with a cigarette lighter in it. Same cable, it just enables me to power the GPS unit from my cigarette lighter. So if I'm sitting in my truck, I can play games. I can also use this in my motel room. We already mentioned the external antenna. The other thing, unless you're married to a battery supplier, get yourself rechargeable batteries. The newer ones are getting better, but the old ones eat batteries, and even the new ones. And I can tell you that this very variant of the Garmin will eat a set of double A's in about 6.5 hours, as fresh as I can get them. Well, if you go to the internet, you can find people who sell rechargeable batteries. These things will take me through a full 9-hour day and have enough to go 2 or 3 hours the next morning, and then recharge them. And so you can actually just recycle the batteries, and if you keep an extra pair in your pocket, these deliver more of their milliamp hours, I guess, in this size battery. We think of our car batteries as amp hours, but these milliamp hours, these rechargeables do that, and they're a set of two costs you about $7. So if you do the math, it doesn't take very long to figure this out. They also work really well in your digital cameras and everything else you got. You know, instead of being carrying compasses around now, we carry batteries. And that was one of the things I taught our forestry camp. It became obvious, you know, we used to carry a box load of diameter tapes and everything else and writing materials and rulers and that whole nine yards. We started carrying computers and batteries and battery chargers and network cards and GPS units and digital cameras, and it got out of hand. But definitely get some rechargeable batteries, because you will spend a lot of money. The newer ones are getting better on battery stuff, but you're going to run out of... it's still nice to have the rechargeables. DNR Garmin, learning to use that program, it's really easy to use. It's designed for forestry technicians. It's designed for foresters and the kinds of things we want to do. I think it'll even calculate the areas for you that you need. It's really a slick program. Even if you do, it works with ArcView, so if you're into the GIS side of things, it's just an extension of for ArcView. You plug your GPS unit into the computer, and your data automatically go into your GIS. And you can move data back and forth. You don't have to have ArcView, but this helps.
Is there a URL for that
I can get it for you. It was a big, long thing, and it wrapped about 5 times, and I don't know. But if you just Google DNR Garmin, it'll pop up. These are some links that'll help you. Garmin. Trimble's got a website on introductory GPS. Obviously, they're hawking their products, but you need to know about that. You need to know what you're trying to accomplish. If you're going to survey, this isn't going to help you. But if you're going to be working around the woods, laying out landlines, cruising timber, the GPS, this kind of thing is probably effective for you. These guys have a little explanation on GPS as well. This GPS visualizer site, it's online. I wasn't sure that we'd have an internet connection here or not. But you can actually go there and make maps online with your GPS. You plug it into your computer. It'll upload the coordinates there. You make your map, print it out, walk away. It's free. And this is where the Coast Guard was selling this thing. So a lot of that stuff about trends and stuff came from that presentation, because they're the ones that are really pushing this domestically, it seems, at least for the civilian use.